Hi guys, welcome to Let's Talk BD, the official podcast of the BD School, the first educational platform entirely dedicated to business development. Here we interview business development professionals working in the field every day, as well as startup founders, so they can give you all the insights, tips, and best practices to help you become a better business development professional. Let's get ready for the next episode. I'm Lucia and I'm your host, and today with me there is Ron. Hi, Ron.
Hello.
So Ron is the founder of Conversion Crew, and today with him we're going to talk about his entrepreneurial journey so far, but also about lead generation and possibly more. So without further ado, let's talk BD, Ron. Can you tell us more about what you do at Conversion Crew?
Hi, Lucia. Well, thanks for the invitation. What we do at Conversion Crew is basically lead generation, but aside from that, also implementing a system to also manage your CRM, customer service, and basically all your marketing tasks. So that's basically what we do.
Awesome. And we see a nice logo behind you. Does it have something to do with what you do?
Well, coincidentally, it does. We work with HubSpot, which is probably known by a lot of people now because they're gaining a lot of momentum. It's sort of an all-on-one platform for the CRM marketing and customer service part. And what we do is implement this system and then after that make sure that customers get everything out of it what is possible. So yeah, that has a lot to do with it. Yeah.
Cool. Well, I mentioned it for guys you cannot see, but there is the HubSpot logo right behind the Ron. And HubSpot is definitely one of my favorite companies so far. I think they're really smart in the way they set up their company. So yeah, that's nice that we share this love in common for HubSpot. So when did you start Conversion Crew, actually?
Well, almost exactly 5 years ago, 2016, I started Conversion Crew. That moment, I didn't know how to differentiate and was looking for that in regards to every other online marketing agency in the world. And within 2 weeks, HubSpot gave me a call and asked me if I would be interested in becoming a partner because they were looking very hard for new partners in the Netherlands. And their philosophy and their culture and simply the way they talk and think and the inbound marketing methodology, which they developed 15 years ago, just clicked with me in such a big way that from that moment on, it was all love on both sides and we're working together for 5 years now. So that's how it all came about.
Nice, really cool. So Conversion Crew is not your first company then. Was there something before?
Yeah, there was a lot before. Well, not a lot, but there were a few companies before. Actually started in 2001 with my first company. It was just a one-man show and I actually am an optician, also certified optician.
Oh, nice.
Within a year, I was working in a store and I thought, well, I'm not going to do this the rest of my life. And in the evening, I was building websites all the time, which secretly I loved a lot more. So I made that my company and first part-time, I started building websites for opticians. So I could use my knowledge and network in the optic-related sector. To build websites, and that was around 2001, and you actually had companies there who did not have a website, so that's a totally different
time. True that.
Online marketing didn't even exist back then. But yeah, that's how I started out, and I did that for 5 years. And after that, I worked at a few other companies just as an employee, because I wanted to learn and work at several companies to learn as much as possible. But I still had in the back of my mind that I wanted to have my own company again. Firstly, in the evening hours, I started a web shop in sunglasses, which was one of the first in the Netherlands in the time where everybody said, well, nobody is going to buy sunglasses online. You're absolutely crazy.
Especially in the Netherlands, there is no sun.
Yeah, that's a good one. US and Italian can definitely talk
exactly.
About
that. Exactly.
That's a very good point. But we only sold Italian sunglasses, so that should make up for something.
Okay, yeah.
Mostly maybe. But so that was a really cool experience. And that was in the time where online marketing was up and coming. So around 10 to 15 years ago, not 10 years ago. So everything I learned about online marketing, I did in this web shop. And that was a lot of fun to do. Only I still after that wanted to full-time completely have my own agency, my own company. And that's what happened in 2016 with Conversion Crew.
Awesome. And what were the main lessons that you brought with you from the first experience as an entrepreneur when you started Conversion Crew? Maybe two or three.
I think that's really a good question. I think the first company, it was really alone and I had no idea what I was doing. At least it felt that way. When looking back, I thought, well, it wasn't so bad, because when I started working with other companies, I noticed that they also don't know what they're doing. So that's maybe my most important lesson. Like, it doesn't matter that it feels like you don't know what you're doing. I mean, of course, just read books, get a coach or talk to other entrepreneurs. Absolutely. But don't let that feeling discourage you right away. I think that's maybe my biggest lesson. So when I came back to starting a company again, I was more comfortable. I was a little bit older as well, but I was a little bit more comfortable with, okay, I don't know a lot of things. I have to learn a lot. Let's just start and let's just go from there. And I think that's the biggest difference. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, and that's very interesting that you put it that way, because I think everyone who's starting with a company, I mean, nobody prepares you for a career as an entrepreneur. You know, it's more you have an idea and you really have this feeling that you have to do it, and then everything else, you know, is secondary. But it is challenging, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah, because when my first company in 2001, I had no idea what I was doing, and I thought, well, I'm going to work at these other companies to learn. Then I noticed, well, they don't know a lot of things as well. And of course, several other things they do know very well. So I absolutely learned a lot of stuff there. And in the end, before I started Conversion Crew, I thought, well, now I have so much experience that what they're doing, I can do as well. So I went into Conversion Crew with a lot of self-confidence. Like, I've seen it all, what I needed to see. So now I can do what they do. And still, it's completely different. And when you actually do it for yourself and actually start your own business, you just have to do it to learn it, I think.
Yeah, totally. And I think every company has a, let's say every entrepreneurial journey probably has its own story, right? So it's never the same for all of us. And cool. What do you find the most challenging being a founder of a company?
Well, even though we do just have people with us working in the team, fortunately, it's still can be very lonely, because there are not many colleagues around you who you can actually talk to about everything. I mean, you cannot discuss everything with your employees, of course. You have to, that's a different relationship. So you have to look outside of your company to have people who can talk to you on who you can actually level with on the level that you need to talk about. So that makes it a little bit lonely, that you're usually the only one in the room who can, who has to think about a lot of things where employees can't think about. So that's the lonely part about it. And you have to do everything yourself. So especially when you start out alone or with only one or two people, you have to do everything. So you have to do work for customers, but you also have to do your administration and your vision and your goals and all that stuff, your finances. You have to do everything yourself, because you can't simply hire an entire team to do everything for you. So I think as a startup entrepreneur, you need to be incredibly flexible to constantly switch between tasks. And I think that's one of the hardest things about it.
Totally. And I can totally relate with both of them. And I remember also the first time we talked, we talked a bit about this loneliness of entrepreneurs. So it was actually really cool to get to know each other and at least have a bit of a high level conversations, founder to founder. So I hope you guys enjoy as well hearing our stories. And because now we're talking about organization and delegating as well, that's something I'm currently busy with. I'm trying to becoming better at organizing myself, but especially at delegating. How did you do that? Like, how did you win this, you know, like willingness, let's call it willingness, to do everything yourself and then start trusting someone else to do it for you?
I think that's a huge shift, which a lot of entrepreneurs need to go through, because one of the strengths to starting your company is that you're actually willing to do everything yourself and you're capable of doing everything yourself. So that's a huge talent, which not everybody has. Then secondly, when you're past this stage and you get so busy that you simply can't even do everything yourself anymore, then you need to learn how to delegate. And if you're really smart and good at it, you probably do it sooner before you get into trouble. And that's, for me, was really hard in the beginning. And I'm sure that a lot of founders have this problem because you know how everything works. You've learned a lot. You can do everything. the way it's supposed to be done. And of course, you probably have a strong opinion because that's why you started a company in the first place, because you thought, well, I can do everything better.
Yeah.
And then delegating is extra hard. So it's a step that's definitely a learning process, and you need to learn to let go and learn to accept it when the other one makes mistakes you wouldn't have made. It's a really learning process, but if you do learn to let go and let the other one do it, and you see that it starts to work, then it's really fulfilling as well, because your agenda frees up and you can see the other person grow because they are learning a lot of stuff. They are happy with what they're achieving, and customers aren't calling you anymore, but they're calling your colleague. And that's a real revelation as well. So there's a really beautiful side to that too, but it's absolutely a learning process. And I think in general, to add, I think the company you're building is really a reflection of who you are. Because if you're not able to let go, then your company will never grow. And if you're not able to trust people, same story, your company will go nowhere, or you'll just stay alone. So I think it's really a reflection of who you are as a person as well.
Awesome. That was very, very useful. And I really needed to hear it from another founder, because I'm really like trying to let go of many things. I had actually just an anecdote, and it happened yesterday. You know, I told the team, guys, this quarter, I want to delegate more. And then one of my colleagues sent me a message and said, I fucked up this thing. And I was like, okay. So like, you're testing my skills right away. And you know what? I'm not even going to check. I trust that you did the right thing, changing it and so on. And indeed, nothing bad happened. So it was nice.
Yeah, it's a real learning process. Yeah.
Totally, totally. But definitely challenging at the beginning, I would say. And how was when you hired the first person? Like, what type of resource did you hire first? And how was it? How was this change from being just you and then having someone else in the company?
Well, I don't want to mention too many cliches, but I actually got into contact through a friend of mine with a girl who worked as an intern at the Total gas station, the main headquarters of those companies. He said, well, she's really good, and she's really good character and enthusiastic and smart and has all the qualities you probably want in your company. And I talked to her, and we connected really well. And I just thought, well, I don't even know exactly which tasks she's going to do in my company, but she's the kind of person I want to have in my team. So just based on seeing that she's talented, and just somebody I would love to have in my company and also represent towards my customers. And just because of that, those qualities, which are usually, in my opinion, and that's the cliche I'm coming up with, usually more important than the experience that somebody actually has. I decided just to hire her and see how it goes. And she actually is still with us. Well, I have to say, she came back to the company. She's been away for about a year and a half, but she's actually came back awesome. To us, fortunately. And she's still one of my best colleagues. So, yeah, that's how it went with my first hire. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. Also here, I can relate. I think especially at the early stage, I mean, we're all learning anyway. So it's not that you're that much much more advanced than the colleagues that you want for specific tasks anyway. So, but that's funny because especially when you hire very junior employees for startups, they at least it happened to me just last week that they come and say, but you know, if you expect me to be good already, you know, I have to learn. I was like, chill out. We're all learning. So no worries. So it was interesting, you know, to see also the perception of the candidates in relation to your company. And it's like, that's okay. Just, you know, as long as you really want to do this, I'm sure we can make it, work.
Absolutely. When you encounter somebody who has this really entrepreneurial mindset, like, okay, if the process isn't there, which is in a startup almost always mm-hmm. the case, I'm just going to create one myself. And if I don't know something, I'm just going to Google it and find out myself. If somebody has that kind of mindset, then everything will work out anyway.
Totally. And it saves a lot of time. And talking a bit more about something different. So, and it's more about what you do, because of course you're specialized in lead generation among the other things. And of course, lead generation is definitely I guess probably the only thing that all business developers and founders have in common in this big world of BD. So do you have maybe one or two techniques, lead generation techniques, that you've seen work most of the times with your clients?
Yeah, there is no quick fix. So there are some quick wins maybe, but there's definitely no quick fix to this. What you do see is that almost in every sector, there are now players who do very well online. So there's competition for everyone. And the one thing I would recommend is just create great content. That's the one thing. And if you look at the inbound marketing methodology, if you look at that from HubSpot, and they also have free training in this, which is highly recommended because it's really high quality. They explain to you exactly how to draw people towards to you with more a magnet kind of approach instead of just screaming big ads to them and placing a billboard on the street. No, it's more like, I'm going to help you out first, and then hopefully someday you will become a customer. That's definitely what I would recommend to startup founders as well. Just start helping people. Start be helpful on forums. Start be helpful on LinkedIn. Just create time in your calendar to daily, for example, take half an hour just to respond to people on LinkedIn. If I look at where our own customers are coming from, it's almost all just our own network, but that's almost all created through LinkedIn, just by posting interesting stuff, responding to people, helping people, and that kind of thing. So awesome. Great content and being helpful is the one thing everybody should do first.
Cool. And I'm happy that you mentioned content first because, well, being a huge fan of HubSpot, of course, I embraced their methodology from the beginning. So from the very beginning of the BD school, that's indeed the first thing we did. First investment we did in terms of time, energy, was all on content. And then I had some friends that would tell me, yeah, but you know, like, you shouldn't focus on content now because it's too long term and, you know, it takes time. I'm like, but even especially because it takes time, you know, you need to start early on because otherwise, how do you do that?
You should play the long game because that's what you want to do as a company anyway. And of course, you can fire off some ads, but people are blind to them for a large part anyway. And if they then land on your website and they don't see great content, then they're gone anyway. So start with great content first. And yeah, that takes huge amount of time. It's really only after a few months you can see some thing happening. So yeah, you should really play the long game in that regard. And to add to that is that a tool like HubSpot is great. And you need something like that, for example, to have a CRM and to be able to send out marketing emails. That's something you want to be able to do from day one. But if you just take the starter version of €50, you can already do that. And I should definitely save the really cool stuff. Everybody wants to start with marketing automation right away because it's really hip and happening. It's a really cool term.
Yeah.
But I really wouldn't start out with that at all. Let's get your basics right first. Start with great content, create a blog, that kind of stuff. Send out some interesting emails. If you only do those things first, then at least for the first year, you're more than fine. And only when the amount of leads starts to increase and you say, well, now I'm too busy following up on leads and I want to shift who's interesting and who isn't. And I need some system to manage this huge amount of contacts better with, then things like marketing automation become interesting.
Awesome. And that's amazing because as I said before, so lead gen is really like a huge topic. And I feel in BD, very often we do more like a proactive role. So we do more maybe outreach and so on. And we really underestimate the power of content, which, I mean, doesn't mean only the blog, right? Nice posts on LinkedIn can take you a long way, right? So I have a question more on your process, you know, when you work with customers, because, well, as BDs, our job is also to bring leads. And sometimes it's difficult to decide, okay, we're going to do this or maybe this other thing, and then you get lost. So when you work with your clients, how do you assess what they need first? Do you maybe have some tips or some, you know, I don't know, criteria that you use to advise a specific lead generation technique to your clients?
Absolutely. We usually work with personas as well. However, the persona type thinking is starting to get a little bit less in the market already as well. But in general, to do a good piece of research on who your target audience is always a good idea. Who are they? Which platforms are they? What is their average age? What kind of people are they? That's always good to know. So always start first with that. And what do they need? And what do they want? And then create content for that. That's definitely the first step to take, I think.
Awesome. Yeah, that's great. So guys, please do focus on content. And in our course, actually, we have big part of content, actually. And we help people so to create their content. Exactly, because of my experience when I started the BD school, I was like, yeah, but this works, you know, so why we're not doing it in BD? So now we can do it, and we got one more, let's say, confirmation from you. So, and you're the expert.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I think inbound should be central in your approach, but you can definitely combine it, of course, with other outreach techniques. I mean, you shouldn't maybe focus only on inbound from day one. It should maybe be your main activity, but it depends on the customer, but it can also be very valuable to do put out a few ads and to do maybe a little bit of outreach by phone, for example. So that can definitely should be assessed for every situation differently.
Mm-hmm. But, cool. And at Conversion Crew, what lead generation tools or techniques do you use? And you can filter out the ones you don't want to say. Competitors don't listen.
None of them are really exotic. I mean, I think our way of lead generation is the way we advertise to customers as well, because we want to be a good example for ourselves too. And we can still do better in that regard. I mean, we have customers where we do better work than for ourselves, because the customer still usually comes first. So what we do is we get a lot of leads coming from, simply inbound. So through our website, because people download stuff or would download a white paper or an ebook or that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. A lot comes in through that. And I also get a lot of just personal messages on LinkedIn from somebody who says, well, you're talking about HubSpot all the time on LinkedIn. Now we want to have a more professional situation in our company. So let's talk. So that's a really important source. And the other one is mouth to mouth, because current customers sometimes refer us to other companies, which is also very nice when that happens. So those are our three main sources where we actually get new customers. Yeah.
Awesome. And if I can translate it, I would say probably the last part is really all about relationships, right? And making sure that you do a good job, of course, but that you're also able to leverage the connections you make with people.
Absolutely, because there's been some recent research from the past year where it was told that actually the more important, the biggest lead generation source currently is actually mouth to mouth. It's not marketing. Mm-hmm. So that important is your relationship with the current customers as well. Yeah, if you really delight them to talk in the terms that HubSpot uses this flywheel where they say, well, you should. When people came in, you should also delight them after they came in and give them such a great experience that they become ambassadors for your brand. That's all because HubSpot also sees that mouth-to-mouth is the best source to have leads from.
Awesome. Cool. Thank you so much for this intro into the lead generation work. And now for the last few minutes, I always like to talk more about our own personal interests, or country of origin. Most of the times, actually, we end up talking about that. This time, we actually play at home. So we're both in the Netherlands, both in Rotterdam, actually. If you had to recommend a place in the Netherlands to someone that wants to come visit, what would that be? What's your favorite place in the Netherlands?
Actually, it is my own personal favorite place. Not to say that it is the best place in the Netherlands. But my best place in the Netherlands is Delft, which is my city of birth. And I'm still so much in love with that city and still living there. And it's also really nice for tourists to visit. So it's actually a really nice experience to come to. So that's my personal favorite. Yeah.
Cool. And what is it that you like the most about Delft?
It is officially a city, but it's really more a village when you walk in it. It has a really small city center with really historic buildings and really lovely sites with all this water flowing and really great buildings, old buildings. I don't want to compare it to Amsterdam, but it has a little bit of some of that atmosphere in the center as well, mm-hmm. Which I personally really like.
Awesome. Yeah, no, I agree. I also really like Delft. It is really cute. And that's also more like the type of, like, that's how I imagine the Netherlands to be, you know? So when I moved to Rotterdam, so guys, if you want to come to Rotterdam, be prepared, because it's all but the typical Dutch village that you imagine. It's all modern. Yeah, it's. I was shocked when I arrived, because I've only been to Amsterdam before Rotterdam. I was like, well, what is going on here? And indeed, like, it's nice to go so to visit like Delft, for example. I really like it. Well, it's really close to Rotterdam, so it's convenient, but it is indeed very cute. And I also found that people are very welcoming there. I had a very nice, like, once we cycled there from Rotterdam, and then we ended up in a bar, and all the people were so nice, and we started dancing together and drinking together, beer, of course. But very welcoming people in Delft, I would say.
Sounds good. Yeah, I can only confirm that, of course. But yeah, sure. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, Ron, thank you so much for this interview. It was really insightful and definitely helped me, especially the delegation part. If people are looking for services like yours and they need some help with the HubSpot implementation or maybe lead generation, what's the best way to reach out to you?
Well, you can simply go to conversioncrew.com or send me an email at ron@conversioncrew.com. And you can definitely get into contact with us that way. Yeah.
Awesome. And I guess there is a very powerful inbound lead machines on your website. So guys, go check it out, conversioncrew.com. So Ron, thank you so much for today. And everyone, I'll see you in the next episode.
Thank you.